Hi, welcome to the Photo Focus and Skip Cohen University Hangout. We're talking about Mind Your Own Business. Skip, what do we have on today's show?
Oh, this is a kick today, Rich. We've got Michele Celentano with us today. And I've known Michele probably for close to 20 years, meeting her for the first time in Newark Airport when there were probably 20 photographers on that flight and everybody was heading to the WPPI convention back in my Hasselblad days. Over the last 20 years, I've watched her skill set grow. I've watched her style grow. She's absolutely become one of the finest family portrait photographers in the world. But it's funny. It's not her skill set that dazzles me the most. It's her passion for the craft that really sets the standard. In fact, a few times over the years, I've introduced her at programs, and I told her I was going to say this again today. I usually introduce Michele as proof that hyperactive kids grow up and get jobs. Because she's all energy. She's never taken shortcuts when it comes to quality. That includes more than just her images. It's about her life, her family, her friendships. When you're at her house, her kitchen is a no-phone zone because a kitchen is all about family and conversation. She's a writer. She's an artist. She's a photographer. She's an educator. She's a physical fitness instructor. She's a great mom, wife. She's an amazing cook. And Michele, shut me up already and just say hello.
I don't know who you're talking about. Oh, my gosh. Anytime I need an ego boost, I just call Skip, and it's so good. Thank you.
It's really intimidating to be in Michele's kitchen because she spent more money on knives for cooking than we probably have in the entire liquor cabinet and wine cellar. So it's an investment in her inner cooking skills, which are just like her photo gear.
It's how I enforce the no phone zone as well.
With the knives, yeah. So, Rich, the topic today is finding that balance between fine art and photography, and I'm just going to jump in to start. One of the things that I love about what Michele does, Michele doesn't sell images. Michele sells art, family heirlooms. She's got some really strong feelings about believing in prints, and in fact did a guest post that I've got up on the SCU site called I Believe. And with that, Rich, you always do such a great job getting the conversation going. That's where we're going today, though.
Excellent. Well, I think it's important as we take a look at this to really focus on ways that we can connect with our clients. And Michele, I know that you often go with a real personal connection to your clients as you're creating images for them. Why don't you tell folks a little bit about the type of clientele you work with and some of the things you try to do from the get-go?
Well, I work primarily with families, so people with children, families with my favorite ages are like 8 to 18 when kids are old enough to pay attention and listen and have interaction with their parents. I mean, I photograph families of all ages, but it's really a matter of meeting with parents before you do the session so that you can get an idea of what their family is like, what their kids are interested in, because the best way to connect and get kids to give you natural expressions is to talk about things that they're interested in as opposed to trying to get them to smile. I think one of the most personal things I do with mom is I really coach parents not to over-prep their children for portraits. And it's natural. Parents do it. They're spending a lot of money on portraits. Mom wants her kids to behave perfectly. You know, she wants to portray that image of her really well-behaved children. And so sometimes, especially with little ones, if mom is, you know, better behave, do what all the photographer says, I want your nice smile, not your, you know, cheesy smile. Or sometimes parents standing over your shoulders and trying to direct kids after you've already done that. And being able to sort of shut that down and let kids come out of their shell naturally with conversation and not with expectations. So that's really how you get to the heart of kids and relationships with families, and letting that flourish in front of the camera is just by letting them be and not over-directing and over-prepping, but learning about them as people and talking to them about what's important to them, sports, school, favorite movies, characters, activities that they are engaged in, karate, dance, ballet, favorite princesses. I mean, you name it, and kids just want to engage and talk, and that's the personal aspect of it.
Cool. And as you're making these connections, why do you think people get so strung up and nervous? You know, is it the pressure that this is going to be a permanent portrait? It's such a huge milestone. I mean, how do we get the parents to not get in the way of the portraits? Or how do we get the spouse member who's trying to coordinate the whole family together to calm down a little bit? Do you establish trust early on?
Yeah, and I often suggest they do a shot before they leave. No, I'm just kidding.
You serve wine at your studio? I've actually served wine at mine.
I suggest it comes with wine. No, I think that the bottom line is no one really likes to be photographed except teenagers taking selfies, but that's a whole different program. But most people aren't really comfortable in front of the camera, and most people will tell you they don't like the way they look in pictures because most people don't take the time to be photographed professionally by someone who knows how to pose them and relax them and make them look thinner and younger. And so most moms come into the studio and they say, well, yeah, I'd really rather you just photograph the kids. I don't want to be in the pictures. I don't like the way I look. I'm 10 pounds heavier than I want to be. I've got all these wrinkles. And, you know, I really have to talk to moms about what it means to your kids to have these pictures and these portraits. And if you're not in them, what are you leaving behind for your children? And I've never heard a kid say, wow, Mom, I really wish you would have lost 10 pounds before you had that picture taken. I mean, kids love you for who you are. So I think people get very anxious and nervous in front of the camera because they're self-conscious and they don't like the way they look until they've been photographed properly by someone who knows what they're doing. And so I have moms come back and say, that's the best I've ever looked in a portrait. I love what you, how did you do that? And it's, you know, I say, because it's not a crappy lens on a phone camera from a bad angle with horrible light. This is a professional portrait.
Skip, where do you want to go?
Well, I want to go right into Michele's I Believe, which she hit briefly on just now. But the challenge today, and we hear it all the time, we hear photographers arguing over the point about, you know, the client just wants a disc, the client just wants a jump drive with the images. And the reality is, where are those images going to be in the future? Michele, I'm just going to let you lead right into that because it makes such a strong point about the legacy and the fact that each portrait like that really does become part of a family heirloom.
Yeah, it does. I think all of our pictures do from, and I mean, I speak in terms of being a professional photographer and wanting to provide my clients with actual prints, not files, because God only knows where files are going to be someday, and I have a couple of perfect examples, but this is the I Believe statement that Skip is talking about, and I have it printed on a card, and it goes in my client packet when they come in so that they can sit and read why it is I believe in making prints and not just delivering a file. But on a personal note, yesterday Clay Blackmore sent me an email with a bunch of pictures that Monty, my great friend and mentor, had taken at WPPI in 2001. My daughter was 3 weeks old. I traveled to Vegas with an infant because I was doing a program, and Monty photographed us during the trade show. I haven't seen that image in 13 years. And if Clay had not found it in some old hard drive, it would have been lost forever. So the first thing I did this morning was I printed it out, because otherwise I would have never had a print of it. So here it is, 13 years later, a lost file that I almost forgot was that even existed. But it's the first real picture portrait I have with my infant. And so this right here today, yesterday, what happened, it solidifies everything I believe about printing our work, because all these pictures mean something. And 13 years ago, I couldn't even put it on this, right? I had nowhere to put it. It was just a file. And so this is money. Like, this is everything to me. Like, one, it's my daughter, and two, it was taken by my mentor. So I think Clay really gave me the greatest gift yesterday when he sent this to me, and I printed it today. So, I mean, I'm always printing. Like, you know, all my candids of my family, put them in albums. Like, what happens to this someday in 20 years? What happens to this picture from my stepdaughter's wedding in 20 years when I forgot we even took it and it's on a hard drive somewhere? And maybe it's stored on a cloud, but do you even remember where it is that you took this picture? You won't remember it unless you print it. I'm getting very excited because I'm so passionate about making prints because we get stuck in the, oh, just we can see it on our phone, we can see it on our iPad, but in 5 years you've forgotten about it unless you printed it. Unless you've printed it, you've forgotten about it. I mean, I have another one really cute I have to show you, of course, of my daughter that I found not too long ago when she was dressed up for Halloween. Hang on, I'm looking for it. And I'd forgotten about it, but she's so stinking cute, and of course, I don't know where I put it. But here's a picture of me working on cruise ships from, I don't know, 20 years ago, 24 years ago. I was dressed as like a one of you, like, I don't know. But if this was a digital file, I wouldn't know where it is today. But it's printed. I have it. I can look at it. So, yes, I'm so passionate. We're getting lazy. We're getting lazy with our clients. We're getting lazy with our own memories. And we're going to have a generation of pictureless people. And it's going to be so sad. And so print, you know, print, print.
two things that I want to jump in with, Rich. First of all, we've got an audience, Michele, that is literally of all ages and all experience in the photo industry. For those of you who don't know who Michele's mentor was, and a lot of you don't, she's talking about Monty Zucker, who really was one of the very, very best, let's go top three portrait educators in the industry. And the legacy that we have as artists, as members of the photographic community today, was all established by people like Monty and Don Blair, and there's so many others that Michele studied under Monty for years. And then developed her own style. Clay and Monty worked together for years, and then Clay, as he grew, developed his own style. But with both of you, for example, you took the best of what Monty taught and brought it into your own style. Now, the second thing I want to add to everybody, and Michele, maybe you'll talk a little bit about this too, Michele is what I refer to as a full-service photographer. Not only does she not want to give a client, you know, images on a jump drive where they'll never know where they are, but when that print is ready, she shows up at the client's house with a hammer and a nail and a lever and a level and a picture hook, and she's ready to hang it in wherever they had originally talked about it. And that's all part of the process of not only selling big prints, but getting the family to understand that, hey, I'm not just coming in to take a picture so that you've got, you know, your annual holiday card. I'm coming in to create a family heirloom. And let's talk about where it's best going to look. Let's talk about what kind of frame it needs to be framed in. What's the style of the client? She really builds that relationship, which is something we've talked about in some other webcasts and some other episodes of Mind Your Own Business.
Yeah. It's just so important. I really deeply feel that if we just hand people these virtual files, I mean, that's what they are. They don't really exist. Where are they? Like, it's nothing tangible. And if that's what we give to people, the only thing that we offer to people, we're doing our clients a huge disservice. One of my favorite things to do in addition to the wall portraits is albums, because it's tangible, it's tactile. You know, people can touch them and look through them and put them on the coffee table and share them with people who come to their home. And so maybe you don't want to put up 20 portraits from the session we did in your home, but putting them and printing them in an album is another great way to do that. And so you really, as a business person, have to define what it is that you believe in and that you find important. In my home, pictures are important. They're all over. You can probably see behind me on my bulletin board, there's prints. There's framed prints all over my house. There's albums. I mean, it's what I believe in. And if I just handed someone images or virtual files, air on a drive, it would haunt me for the rest of my life. I really think so.
Well, so to that end, one of the things that I think people struggle with images is the perception that when we're getting those images to clients, how we're pricing images. What I mean by that is that many people, there's been a devaluing in printing. I have to sneeze once. Excuse me.
Bless you.
All right. That's the first sneeze on a Mind Your Own Business episode.
Yes, yes. That one was priceless. Sorry.
Yes, and it will not be edited out.
Nope, nope, not at all. So there's this perception that, oh, I can get my own prints, or the clients are just going to order their own prints, or they can click and do that, or they can take the files in themselves. I know that photographers have different perceptions on what a good print is or what a good lab is, but how do we balance this out? The need for us to make the prints versus allowing the client to make the prints, just as making sure that the images end up in print somehow. How do you balance that out?
Well, the first thing is I find that once you hand people the images, they don't make prints. They don't. They get lazy. They put it in a drawer. They forget about it. Maybe they'll back it up on a hard drive and think, oh, someday or, you know, next month I'll get to it. I'll make that print. It seems like, oh, something I'll get to, and you never do. And then hard drives crash. You know, images get lost. I mean, it's just the problem is people aren't making prints. And if they are, then they're taking them to, you know, inexpensive printers who aren't doing a professional job. And I care about my work enough to make sure that it's color corrected, it's density corrected. That's my reputation on the line. When you go into someone's home and you look at a portrait on the wall, if it's not beautifully done, even though maybe it's a nice picture, you're going to think, oh, well, that photographer's not that great. And people do know the difference between outstanding and bad. I mean, they do. Maybe not between mediocre and above average, but they do understand when something is green or blue or, you know, cropped incorrectly. So I think, you know, it's a pride in what we do. I mean, you don't go to a hairdresser and they hand you scissors to cut your own hair. Like, it just doesn't happen. That's a good one, right?
That's a good one. I like that.
So that makes sense, but getting people to understand that it can come off as protectionist, that we're trying to, you know, be controlling, and sometimes photographers are seen as being a service. And so where does that service end? How do you convey to your clients why you should be involved in this process? Not that this is important, but, you know, how do you do it in a way that deepens their appreciation for you as a provider rather than makes them feel like you're being pushy?
Okay, so strictly from a business standpoint, right, we have expenses. We have salaries to pay, overhead, insurance, further education, affiliations with our associations. I mean, there's so many, just to run a business, you have expenses. So, okay, so this 5x7 piece of paper is $1.50, but what did it really cost me to create the image on this paper, or Monty? How many years of education, how many dollars in education, in practice, in hours, in equipment? And so, sure, I'll charge you $1.50 for the paper, but then the actual image, well, that's for my time and my talent, that's going to be $50. So it's $50, $51.50 print. I mean, it's like going to the attorney and saying, well, you just drew up some paperwork, how much is the paper? Because you pay for their time, for their expertise, for their education. And I think that a lot of new photographers getting into the business forget this. It's not just the service of taking the picture, but it's everything that goes in behind it. It's the culling, the editing, the retouching, the composition, the education, the equipment, the insurance. Like, we're here to make a living, to feed our families, and to do something that we love doing and to provide people with the best possible product. So if you look at an image and all you're thinking of is the value of a piece of paper, well, then you're probably not my client. But if you come to me because you know I'm going to make you look good, I'm going to retouch correctly, your kids are going to look amazing, I'm going to come to your home, I'm going to put that portrait up on the wall, I'm going to service you at every turn of this process, it's no longer about $1.50 piece of paper that you can get anywhere. It's now about the relationship. It's now about the service, the expertise, and everything that goes along with that. And I think we as an industry have really started to minimize that and to just say, here, take your images, go get cheap prints. Well, fine then. Let's do sessions for $10,000 and give prints and send them to the lab, and at least then you're getting paid for your time and expertise, which I still wouldn't do because I know I want to deliver a finished product that meets my end standard.
So
that
was
a great rate, huh?
Yeah, no, Skip, I want to have you dig a little bit deeper into this, but yeah. You've talked about the idea of, you know, not commoditizing what you do. So, you know, do a certain number of prints come with this portrait sitting? Or are you selling, you know, do you give them the number of prints that makes sense based on the images that turned out? You know, how do we roll this in so it becomes not just another commodity? What are some strategies, either through packaging or through more holistic type servicing, that we can balance this out with folks?
Well, I want to jump in with a prop here that might help make the point. This is a picture frame, and it's one of those frames that we got as a gift. It says, love, there's only one happiness in life, to love and be loved. Love is patient, love is kind, it is not jealous, love does not brag and is never arrogant, and it's got some squigglies. It's a beautiful frame, and I want to share with you this absolutely stunning image I have of me and Sheila. And I can't help but feel that if more photographers had something like this as a prop, in fact, Michele has also offered I believe everybody has been invited to plagiarize the hell out of it. If you go to Skip Cohen University and down in the bottom left corner, just hit I believe in the search box, mm-hmm. It'll take you right to her post. If you go to Michele's site and her blog, you'll find mm-hmm. it in there somewhere. The point is, this makes the point about Michele. Like, where is that image? Now, the actual image that was in that frame is here. It's a fun image that their friend Brian Palmer took a couple of years ago at a program we were at together of me and Sheila on the escalator. But the reality is that's really what we're turning into. Mm-hmm. And you can't feel it. You can't touch it. Especially new photographers, and this is another point that Michele hasn't hit on yet, and it's only because of her modesty. If your images aren't better than Uncle Harry's, then you are going to have a hard time justifying much more than what Kmart is going to get for a family sitting. But if your images have that quality, if you've taken advantage of all the tools, and it's not just in learning how to light and retouch and pose and all the points that Michele made. It's also being able to reproduce that image professionally. It's about printing on canvas. It's about working with a great lab. It's about all those components that Uncle Harry doesn't have access to. And I hear this all the time from photographers that complain about the competition from the serious hobbyist in the community, because, and people have said, they even have better equipment than I do. It's not about the gear. It's about all the things that people are able to do with it. And that's where Michele's education comes in. And, I mean, package pricing is definitely something that's important to bring together. But first, you've got to establish the value with the client of what it is you're selling. And it's not an updated family picture. Sorry, I got on the soapbox too.
That's okay. I think it's also having quality, tangible products that, for canvases, for example, or the gallery blocks, or a collection of gallery blocks, being able to put something together and show a client what things may look like or portraits may look like on their wall is another huge asset. So working with a professional lab, Graphy Studio does the best albums on the market. My clients can't go to an online album company and just get the type of album that I will make for them. It's not the same quality. So you're not only promoting the quality of what you do in your own art, but the quality of the materials and the products that you then extend for sale to the client. I mean, you can't charge a premium and go to Costco and get an album. Like, it's not going to work, because then the client believes, well, I can get the same thing for much less. But if I offer products that they can't get anywhere else that are unique to me as a business, then there's a value in that. So you have to look at your business and decide what it is that you believe in, what you want to give or service clients with, and what it means in the end. I mean, if you know, there are new people coming in all the time who are just like, photography is a great way to make quick money. I take some pictures, burn a DVD, I make money, and I'm done. But really, we're hurting an industry. We really are hurting an industry that is so valuable. It's this industry that protects history, that writes the past that we can visually see. And I've been in this industry a long time, 27 years. I'm way back in the film days. I know it doesn't look like that. I know age is escaping me. I'm just kidding. But, you know, prints are important. Look back at your grandparents' pictures and look back at something that I thought I'd never see again. I forgot about this. I'm so happy I have it. 13 years ago, it would have been a lost file. I have a print now. Like, what? For me, this business is about what you believe in. If you believe in photography, if you believe in prints, and you believe in preserving history and giving families something to look back on, you know, I'm Italian, I'm Catholic, I know someday we're going to be gone, and what do we leave behind for our kids? What are our kids going to look at? What do they have? So anyway, next question.
Go ahead, Skip.
After all that? No, I think the issue starts in the beginning. Michele, let's go into some of the very specific things that you would say to a client. And I mean, you want to role play a little bit?
Sure.
I mean, I want to get a family portrait done, which is interesting too, because one of the things everybody needs to remember, and I've said this on other podcasts, 98% of the purchase decisions to hire a professional photographer in the portrait wedding categories are made by women.
Right.
It's very rare that anybody gets a call from dad saying, you know, we really need an updated family picture.
Right.
It just doesn't happen. But regardless, I'll role play. I mean, Michele, I want to get a family portrait done. All I need, I just need you to get the shot for me because I know you know what you're doing. And my brother-in-law works over at Walmart, and I'm going to run it over there. He's going to print it up for me and make a nice big print for me. Are you going to be okay with that? Because I want to bring my family in.
Hell to the double no. No, I'm kidding. Okay, so here's where the I believe comes in, right? And if you really believe and you're passionate about it, I can say I believe so much in my work that I won't allow an outside source to print it, only because I do not know what the end result will be. And I care about the quality, and so I don't sell my files for reproduction. Now, here's the interesting thing, and here's what I think. I think most people actually just want shareable files. I really don't think the average person wants to bother with making their own prints. But when I think they ask for images, I think what they're asking for is shareable images. So once you have purchased an image, I'm happy to provide you with a social media or device-friendly size shareable image with a logo. Oh, perfect. That's all I really want, so that after I have these at home, I can share them with family and friends who don't live nearby. And so I think sometimes just asking the question of, well, why do you want the files? Are you really going to print them? You know, where do you know a good lab? You know, it's sometimes just saying, what do you want the files for? Well, I just want to be able to share them. Well, great, we can do that after you purchase a print, because that's what you're coming to me for. You can get anybody to stand behind a camera and hit the shutter. That's not what I do. I'm so honest with people, it's scary.
Well, all right, but Michele, I mean, all I want is we're on our way out tonight. All I need is 15 minutes. I just want to get a fast family portrait so I've got something updated. I don't want to make a big deal out of it. Can I just bring the family over? We'll swing by, or can you meet us in the park and get a quick shot? That's all I really need.
If we do that, I really honestly feel that I will not be providing you with the service that I really care about, and it's not the best way to go about taking a portrait. I promise you probably won't be happy if we rush this process, and I just don't want to do that as an artist.
Yeah, but I can't get my wife to sit still. She, you know, she's put on some pounds since we had the baby, and she's not happy with it, and the older kids, and they're not going to sit still.
And that's why when we meet for consultation, I can go over how we will overcome all those obstacles that you're talking about. It seems to me like you maybe had a bad experience with another photographer. So maybe you should come in and we can talk about how I do things differently and why you're not going to want to rush this process.
Well, I mean, Rich Harrington said he'd do it and he'd just for $9.95.
Yes, then that was $9,995, yeah, just to be clear.
Actually, all I needed to do was get him a pizza and an order of fries, and he was going to do our family shot. Why are you more expensive?
Well, if that's what you're comfortable with, I would recommend that that's probably what you should do. I might not be the right photographer for you, so bye. I fortunately enough don't face that a lot because I have such a repeat business and a word of mouth business that people already know what to expect when they come to see me. You have to set an expectation in your business and you have to stand strong in your policies. And this comes into play sometimes when people feel desperate for the business and they get pushed around by a pain in the ass client like you and they give in instead of sticking to their guns and saying, that's not the way I operate as a business, and I know that I will not be servicing you as a client in the best way possible. Here's what we can do. I have so many great options. Really, let's sit down, meet, and talk about it because I can't really explain this to you all on telephone, but I can show it to you in person and explain why my process is going to be very different, and I guarantee that you're going to be happy. My guarantee is this. If you come to me and I take your family portrait and you're not happy with it and you don't want to purchase any photographs, I will refund your session fee 100% because I'm that confident that I know you'll be happy. So you have nothing to lose. If you like the style of my work and you think that you want a family portrait with me, the best thing to do is come in and have it done. And if you're not happy, I'll give you back your money.
You just hit on something that I want to talk about as a spin-off of this, which is relationship building, especially in the portrait arena. About a year and a half, Sheila and I were in Phoenix, and we were invited to a private party there was a book signing party to launch Michele's first book. And there was a table in the backyard. Michele has some great friends around Phoenix, Anthem. There was a table in the backyard that must have been set up for, 40 people, thereabouts?
Yeah.
And somewhere in there, my wife Sheila suggested that everybody go around the table and talk about how they knew Michele. And what was interesting was that probably 60, 70% of the group had gotten to know Michele first as clients, as subjects. And as they went around the room, everybody joked about, how expensive and what their friendship with Michele has cost them over the years. But there wasn't one single person there that didn't recognize that they were sitting at a table with a true artist. Not a photographer, not somebody that was just going to grab a snapshot and get you that updated family photo, but an artist. And that relationship building is so critical in every aspect of your business, and we've talked about it on other podcasts as well. I mean, the new method of marketing is about relationship building. Throw out all the things that you know about traditional marketing and building your brand. It's about relationships, and all these people at the table all started out as clients of Michele's and have kept in touch and are part of the community. Michele, what part of your business would you say is typically repeat on an annual basis from past clients?
Oh, probably 70%.
Okay.
Yeah.
That makes the point right there.
Yeah.
And so as you're getting...
And the funny thing is, holiday time is probably our busiest time. And I love keeping all the holiday cards I've done for people. And when they come in year after year, I show them their whole collection of holiday cards from like the past 5, 6, 7 years. And it's just, and watching their kids change. I've been a part of this community now for 12 years, and kids that I photographed are high school seniors now, and those high school seniors are getting married, and I'm starting to get calls for weddings again, even though I've I don't market for them, because the high school seniors that I photographed or their families are like, well, Michelle has to do the wedding. And so it's sort of like an accidental step back into weddings, which is kind of fun, but not because I marketed it, because of the relationships I have with the clients over the years. And that's what the most important part is. I mean, if somebody calls you and just says, hey, you know, I want a session, or they book you online, and there's no connection, and there's no getting to know your client, and you show up, and you shoot a portrait session, and you edit it, and you just give it to them, what have you accomplished? Like, you haven't made a connection. And what is that person going to say about you to their friends? Oh, yeah, we had this photographer, and we got our pictures done. Done. But when you create that relationship and you create the service, that's when people talk about you. My kids had such a great time. My favorite thing is when people say you really pull out the essence of people. You can see their spirit in the pictures that you take because of the way that you connect with them. So the portraits I create don't have a bunch of like cheesy fake smiles. They really have expression that is who that person is. And so if you don't get to know people, you can't actually get that. You can't. I don't think so.
So as we're building these relationships with folks and we're trying to get them to come back, be long-term customers, what are some of the special things you do with your prints that set you apart? Like, obviously this is something you are passionate about. Mm-hmm. Skip has alluded that you actually will sometimes even install the portrait within people's homes. What are some other things you do to help them really feel the value or that connection? Is there anything extra, or framing choices, or extra copies? How do you really make this something that people connect? Like, you know, I know, for example, I get busy and I look at the photos on my desk, the printed photos of my kids, and they're both a little bit out of date, but, you know, they still bring a smile to my face. You know, you're right. I walk past our wedding photo every day in the house on the way to breakfast. It's in a spot that everybody sees every day to remind us of that important day. What are some things that you can do to help people enjoy this and really appreciate it?
I think the way that we can elevate the service is through packaging, and all of my prints are textured for a couple reasons. I think textured prints just look like they're a step up from just, and also if you go to scan it on a printer, it's not going to look very good. So it's a little bit of a protection, but it also elevates the look of the image. And they're all printed on, mounted on a board, a thick board, not just, you know, I don't want to just give people a $1.50 piece of paper that looks like that. So if you texture it, if you mount it, if you present it in a box wrapped in tissue with a ribbon, you're now elevating that. I mean, you know, I think of Tiffany's and their packaging. It's iconic. I mean, any girl that sees that teal blue box and a white ribbon, it's just, it says something. So to be able to package and present your work in a way that feels like a gift and feels like something more than just a print you could get at Walmart, it's a big deal. I mean, you have to find a way to elevate the work that you do and make it even more valuable than the client thinks it is. And here's the bottom line. 5 minutes after you walk out the door, this print is all of a sudden worth more to that client. I mean, how many of us have gotten a phone call from a portrait session that we've done that somebody passed and they need a portrait and they're sorry they didn't get it and now they need it right away? That breaks my heart. Why didn't you just get it in the first place? You know what I mean? That's the first thing we look for when people pass, the very first thing. We want more pictures of them. We want more pictures, not pictures we can zip through on my iPad, but pictures that we can hold in our hand and look at and enjoy. Okay, so as a photographer, I'm like the shoemaker's kid with no shoes, right? So I was married 4 years before I finally made my own wedding album. And now that I have it, it's just, we love it. Like, we look through it all the time, and we stop and like, look how little the kids were. And so it took me 4 years just because I'm busy with my own life. But Roberto Valenzuela just recently photographed my stepdaughter's wedding, and he sent us this gorgeous slideshow, and it was beautiful, and he's amazing. And as soon as that slideshow was done, I sat back and I thought, well, I want my album now. Like, it's gone. It's done. The slideshow's over. I can't touch it. I can't look at it. I can't flip through it. I can't stop on a page and remember that moment. The slideshow's over. And so I looked at my husband. I'm like, we need an album because I want an album. And that's from a client perspective. I mean, of course, I have a photographer's perspective. But that slideshow ended, and I was like, I feel so empty. They're gone. I need a book. And so I think when you really believe in something, it comes through to people. And I want the clients who appreciate that belief and understand it and want that too. If somebody comes to me and that's all they want and I can't convince them of anything else, they're not the client for me.
We lost your picture, Michele. Can you check your video? We still hear you. You're still
hearing
the audio.
Oh, I had her here.
Oh, okay. That was weird. Maybe it was just my computer. No problem. Well, those are very important points, and I think as you speak with passion, people are gonna connect with you and feel, hopefully, you attract like-minded people. You mentioned being, you know, that people want these images at other points in time. Is there anything that you do, like, have you, when you hear of family members having an important event, maybe it's a graduation, or it's a wedding, or it's a funeral, do you sometimes reach out to them and, you know, pull things out from the archive or offer them prints, or do you re-engage them with past memories as you continue your relationship?
Okay, so I have an interesting story for you. A very good friend of mine, and she started out as a client, and I photographed her children and her sister's children and a very close-knit family. And Tara, who's 37, my client is Gina, my friend is Gina, and her sister Tara passed away 3 years ago from lung cancer, leaving behind two small children, and it was just a devastating, devastating time for all of us. And the first thing that Gina did was she called me and asked me if I could put a slideshow together for the funeral home. And some of the images were things I had taken, but most of it was images of Tara through her whole life. I had suggested to her two years ago that we photograph her parents with all their grandchildren, because they were really close family and her parents were still having a terrible time and really struggling. And I kind of felt like to photograph them together and show them the family that is still there, it would be almost a healing process. And so we did. We made the book for them. And in the beginning of the book, they did a tribute to Tara.
Michele, can you just hold it up, either hold it up higher or tilt your mind? There you go.
Okay. So they did a tribute to Tara in the beginning of the book saying, you know, it actually says, treasured in our hearts, you'll stay until we meet again someday. But then the rest of the book is all the kids together with their grandparents, you know, Tara's kids. We photographed Tara and her husband Tom, Tara's husband Tommy, the kids together, all the cousins together, my friend Gina's kids. We photographed Frank and Anne together, and this book means so much to them because of what's left, and that's a healing process. So I actually had to pull an older picture that I had taken of Tara for the beginning of the book, but that's a healing process for them, and it's an incredible, incredible gift that they would have never thought about doing until I said, oh, I think a great thing to do, and actually I kind of scammed them into it. I asked the Richellis, Gina's parents, if they would be part of my next book project, and I wanted to photograph grandparents and grandchildren together, and they, okay, great, and then Gina gave them the book for Christmas, and they just lost it, and it's their favorite thing, so that's what I do.
Rich, I think a big part of this has to do with the way photographers position it. I mean, as a wedding photographer, for example, you're not selling an album. You're selling the first family heirloom of a new family. And that's really what it is. I mean, the album, and other photographers have talked about this in various programs over the years, but the whole background of a really great album is so that 25 years from now, a granddaughter gets the answer to the question of, Grandma, what did you look like when you got married?
And I'm hoping more than 25 years.
All right, 25. Yeah, that's a good point. Let's go a little more than 25.
I'm just saying.
Well, who knows? Who knows today?
I know.
Yeah, but the whole idea is to preserve those memories. The other thing that I know, and this is something that Joe Busink does, and when I did the book with Joe, on wedding photography, he talks about when the couple comes in to view their proofs, he's got one of the prints that he's picked out from the wedding that's one of his favorites, and he has it enlarged, printed, framed, and on the wall, but he also signs it in the bottom corner because he wants to convey to them that he's an artist, and they don't know that he's even done this. So they come in for their appointment to be able to look and review their images. And as they come in, one of the first things they see is one of their images that Joe took that's one of his favorites, and that's his gift to them. Because there's so much to this business that really is positioning. It's absolutely true. Uncle Harry may have exactly the same camera gear that Michelle does, but Uncle Harry doesn't know how to use it the same way. Uncle Harry doesn't know how to pose. He doesn't know how to light. He doesn't know how to print. He's not working with a professional lab. And he doesn't have access to all of the products today. I mean, one of the things that drives me crazy is when a photographer can't think of what they can do to make themselves different. Just pick up the phone and call your lab and say, what's new? And you're going to find that Michelle was talking about textured prints. There are new things being done with canvas every day. They're printing on wood. They're printing on metal. They're doing metallic prints. There's so many exciting things that are going on. So that it's not just a photograph. It really is a piece of art that you're selling. And that goes back to where we started about finding that balance between photography and fine art. Because if you're just selling photography, it's one thing. If you're selling fine art and family heirlooms, again, it comes back to your positioning and establishing value. And I don't mean to be so wordy today, but this is just such a fun topic for me.
It is. It's a fun topic, and a lot, I think, comes down to, you know, self-worth also. And as new photographers, you just think, I'm not that good, I can't charge that much. Or, you know, we're so connected personally to our art. It's very different than being an attorney and drawing up a paper. You're not emotionally attached to emotion that you might be putting in. It took 2 hours, and 2 hours of your time is $250 each, and so it's a $500 motion. Like, that's that, right? But when we create something that's near and dear to our hearts and that we really do feel passionate about, we all sometimes take a step back and think, well, am I really worth it? Am I good enough? Can I charge for this? And so I think a lot of times we devalue ourselves in a way that maybe someone else doesn't. I mean, the expressions that you create for people are priceless. I mean, they really are. But part of that equation is getting educated and continuing to learn and continuing to advance yourself in your craft and to get better and better and better at what you do. And the problem is that when you start off with super low prices or giving your stuff away because you think you're not worth it, the rate at which you will improve your skills is far greater than the rate you can increase your prices at. So you kind of almost have to start somewhere a little bit above what's comfortable for you pricing-wise. And pricing is such a huge issue. And, you know, I think sometimes people get stuck in their own socioeconomic thought process of, well, I would never pay that for a print. I would never pay that for something on my wall. Well, guess what? There are people who will. And there are people who value it, but you have to start by valuing it yourself and valuing what you do and knowing that you're worth it, knowing that when you're gone, the pictures that you've left behind, the portraits, the family history, is going to outlive you, and it's going to mean more and more and more every year that passes by. If you really hold that in your heart and you know that and you work your butt off to increase your skill level, you'll really start to come into yourself and realize that you are worth charging a premium for what you do. Wow, I'm off on another tangent.
Well, no, it's okay. I mean, I think what I'm hearing you say is to perhaps think a little bit more like a painter and less like a printer.
Mm-hmm.
So that, you know, you are making content here that's meant to last. Well, Michele, why don't you tell folks, give them a couple of closing thoughts and tell them where to find out more about you as well as your website. And Skip, I know you also mentioned a couple of great resources. If we could put those back out and tell people where to find I Believe, I think that'd be great. So Michele, why don't we start with you?
Well, first I want to thank you guys for asking me to do this. One of my biggest passions in life is teaching, and I get that from Monty. He was, in my mind, probably the greatest teacher and giver to this community, this industry that there is. So I teach always in honor of Monty, and so I'll start with that, and thank you for asking me, and thanks for everyone who came to check it out. You can find me on Facebook, Michele Celentano, Portrait Photographer. I also have an online learning group, which is closed and private, so we can share materials and ideas, and I give you constructive criticism and advice and stuff like that, which is the Michele Celentano Learning Group. And I'm on Twitter at Mish, M-I-C-H, Celentano, and my website, michellecelentano.com. I'm pretty easy to find. I have a pretty unique name, so I'm pretty easy to find. But again, thank you for asking me to do this, and I hope that in some way there's someone out there thinking, you know, how do I move forward? How do I charge for my work? How do I convince people that what I do is worth it? And I hope that I was able to give just a little bit of inspiration to help somebody walk away from the computer and think, yeah, I can do this.
No, excellent. You definitely did. And Skip, where can they also find the I Believe on the Skip Cohen website?
Yeah, I believe if you go to skipcohenuniversity.com and just hit the homepage, the search box in the bottom left corner, just type in I Believe, and Michele's guest post comes up right away. And again, Michele has given everybody carte blanche. If you want to reprint that and put it on some nice onion skin stock and have it framed and right there in your studio, it
or
makes
give it to everyone.
That's even better. Hold that up again.
I have it printed, so this is what the front of it looks like, and then this is what the back. So it's how I feel. It gets put in my little folder that I give to all my clients when they come in, and so this way there's no question about it.
That's right, and they absolutely, I mean, it makes a point about the value of the print. Personally, I think going out and buying, go to Pottery Barn and buy one of these frames and just have that on your desk, because that absolutely makes a point. Well, Michele, you're the one that said, what are they going to look at, a framed jump drive?
Right.
There it is. In terms of finding things that I'm working on, it's skipcohenuniversity.com. I'm Skip Cohen on Facebook. I'm Skip Cohen on Twitter. Michele is also part of a group on a new Facebook page we launched recently that connects not only to things that she's doing, but there are 15 primarily portrait and wedding photographers that are involved in a new Facebook page called Going Pro. And that's been a kick, because the whole idea is to be able to help both new photographers starting out or seasoned photographers that are now trying to go in a new direction and need a little bit of help. So that's where you find me. We got Michele. Rich, where are they going to find you?
Well, we have daily content over at photofocus.com. You'll also find, for those of you who joined us a little bit late or want to share this with a friend, this video will pop up on YouTube on the PhotoFocus Facebook, or on the PhotoFocus YouTube channel in just a few minutes. So you can pass that link around, and we'll be running stories with this video again on photofocus.com and Skip Cohen University. So make sure you tell folks about it. This was a great, really heartfelt lesson today. Michele, Skip, I really appreciate you guys speaking so earnestly, and I think it's a healthy challenge. You guys really seem to be asking people to take their craft a bit more seriously and to explain to their clients why they're so passionate. And, you know, we do have an important role to protect memories. So, Michele, I really appreciate your heartfelt advice here for folks today.
Thank you.
Good. Well,
Michele, it was great to have you here. And, Rich, always good hanging out with you for an hour.
All right. Well, thank you guys so much for joining us this week. We'll be back in about a month. And again, if you missed the show, make sure you guys check it out. It'll be available on YouTube, and we'll have it both up on Skip Cohen University and photofocus.com shortly. All right. Thanks again.